Hello, and thanks for joining us on Nationwide on the NTA. I am Runke Kolawole. President Muhammadu Buhari will participate in the 71st session of the United Nations General Assembly UNGA from September 19 to 23, 2016, in New York, United States. The president will deliver Nigeria's statement at the opening of the general debate of the assembly on the theme, the Sustainable Development Goals, a universal push to transform our world. He will also attend a high-level summit hosted by the UN on large movements of refugees and migrants, other meetings and side events significant to Nigeria's interest. The summit, which is the first of its kind organized by the General Assembly, as the heads of states and government are expected to come up with a blueprint for a better international response to enhance protection of migrants and refugees. In a statement, the presidential spokesperson, Femi Adesina, says the president will equally participate in an event hosted by the UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon on ending need in the Lake Chad, signed the Paris Agreement on climate change, participating in activities commemorating the 30th anniversary of the Declaration of the Right to Development, and attend the Clinton Global Initiative, as well as the United Nations Private Sector Forum on Business and Global Goals, organized by the Secretary General. President Buhari will hold bilateral meetings with some world leaders in furtherance of his administration's commitment in ameliorating the plight of internally displaced persons, IDPs, in the country. In the meantime, the federal government says it is continuing with economic policies put in place by previous administrations that have contributed meaningfully to national development. Minister of Finance Kemi Adeosun, while briefing the media on the state of the economy, says so far 420 billion naira has been released for capital expenditure, while another tranche of 350 billion naira is set to be released. Leah Katumba Batunde brings us up to speed on that report.
The Nigerian economy has had its fair share of battering owing to overdependence on crude revenue, which has since declined by more than half, as well as rising cost of inflation, among other negative economic indices that have since thrown the nation into full recession. Minister of Finance Kemi Adeosun, while giving a breakdown of efforts put in place to improve growth and economic stability, said it became imperative to continue with important policies put in place by previous administrations.
The problem we have is that many of the things that people are spending money on are things that government should be doing, roads, power and so on. So we have to address these things.
She also disclosed that the ministry, through the Debt Management Office, has secured approval for external borrowing through the issuance of Eurobonds at 1.5% interest rate.
This government has a very credible plan. This is the best plan we have for Nigeria. It's going to result in an economy that is not dependent on oil.
So the important thing is that we are very focused on the fact that these monies are needed urgently to solve our problem, to turn around the economy.
For now, states have continued to enjoy augmented amounts in addition to the Federation account's monthly distribution to enable them offset their wage burden.
There is no disparity because states have the same virtually issues to do with funding, to do with payment of salaries, those states that are in actual need. So far, it has been run for 3 months.
Infrastructure, agriculture and its value chain, transport, defense and school feeding are among sectors to gain immediate attention for improved economic returns, while reducing the cost of governance remains key.
And we have saved our government by 100 billion of the personal cost for this year.
Kemi Adeosun informed Nigerians that government was aware of current hardship and is not resting on its oars until it wipes off the ugly trend. In Abuja, Leah Katumba Batunde, NTA News.
And now to issues of security. Nigeria is continuing with efforts to elicit international collaboration in addressing issues of insecurity in some parts of the country. Minister of Defense Mansour Dan Ali disclosed this at the inauguration of participants for Course 25 of the National Defense College, Abuja. Defense correspondent Isaac Okuma has that report.
The National Defense College is the apex military institution in Nigeria and sub-Saharan Africa, dedicated to the training of senior military officers and their contemporaries from strategic ministries, departments and agencies of the federal government, as well as senior officers from other countries. Minister of Defense Mansour Dan Ali said with the global security challenges, all avenues must be explored in addressing the issue of insecurity.
The government of President Muhammad Buhari is not leaving anything to chance in this fight against these insurgents. We are also concerned by the spate of attacks on our oil pipelines by militant groups. To arrest this militancy, the Niger Delta will continue to toe the path of negotiation to bring respite to the affected communities through dialogue.
It is this value system that should inform your thinking and actions. We should give you a distinct identity and character that will always be the pride of our nation, your service, and your agencies.
The Minister of Niger Delta Affairs, Usani Oguru Usani, who delivered the inaugural lecture on governance and leadership in Nigeria, imperative for national development, stressed the need for proper dissemination of government policies and programs to the grassroots.
What is communicated to the public is far less than what the government is doing. And communication strategy in an instance like this is important because otherwise, the public for which the government is working will continually misunderstand the people that are on the saddle of leadership, and that can construe a lot of misjudgments which may falsely determine the actions of the people. And so government has a necessity to communicate more effectively and regularly.
The participants, drawn from Brazil, Germany, India, the Nigerian Armed Forces and other African countries, will spend the next 48 weeks strategizing and exchanging ideas on security and policy matters to the benefit of their respective nations, services and agencies. In Abuja, Isaac Nkuma, NTA News.
Meanwhile, the Nigerian Armed Forces has described the latest video released by Boko Haram as diversionary and a desperate attempt by the sect to remain relevant. A statement issued by the Acting Director, Defense Information, Brigadier General Rabia Abubakar, said the video clip is a complete show of weakness and sign that the end is near for the insurgents, hence it does not in any way pose any threat. It says the military is equally not deterred by the Photoshop assemblage of worshippers at the supposed Eid al-Kabir prayer, which is a replica of the video clip released by the sect in 2014 and therefore should be disregarded. The statement added that the Nigerian military is highly committed to do all that is required within its rules of engagement to ensure that no part of Nigerian territory is conducive and habitable for insurgents and any other criminals to stay and operate. It said the military believes so much in making statements through its actions as evidence in its past achievements rather than making noise in propaganda gimmick as exhibited by the Boko Haram elements in its recent video clip. Building an efficient police force is the duty of everybody, hence Nigerians must courageously help to build a police force that can put criminals out of business. This was the submission of the Inspector General of Police, Ibrahim Idris, today on NTA Good Morning Nigeria. Patricia Esamiluba monitored the program and now reports.
The significance of peace and security in every society cannot be overemphasized. Kidnappings and robbery on our highways pose a serious threat to national development. One highway notorious for armed robbery and kidnappings is the Abuja-Kaduna-Kano Highway, even though the rate has declined as witnessed during the recent Eid celebrations.
Obviously, you know, in each of these warning periods, we have an operation order that we normally give to our commands. And like you said, the operation order is on now. And you are still going to see the same deployment. It's a procedure. We respond to situations, you know, appropriately. And we are still going to adapt the same method to address also, I mean, most of these, periodic celebrations that we have in this country.
The IGP seems to have an ambitious and forward-looking agenda for the police force. This stems from his position on sufficient kitten, optimal welfare and trust fund as a panacea for efficient policing in the country.
We've had almost about 4 police reforms in Nigeria, and each of them tried to address some of the problems the police is facing. But up to now, the bill of the Nigerian Police, Nigerian Trust Fund, which is supposed to complement the effort of the federal government in providing funds for the police, is still in the National Assembly since 2009. Nobody considers it important to address that critical bill.
He added that all this can see the light of day if efficient policing is seen as the duty of all. In Abuja, Patricia Esemiluba, NTA News.
And still taking more on security, the 37 Base Services Group of the Nigerian Air Force, ILA, has handed over 6 suspects, including an ex-serviceman, for illegal possession of arms and ammunition to the Department of the State Security in ILA, as reported by Rayan Ubala.
The 6 suspects arrested by men of the Nigerian Air Force were found to be in possession of 2 rifles stolen from the men of the Nigerian Air Force, military uniforms and identity cards. Other items recovered from them include pistols, live ammunition, cartridges and arrows, among others. The commander, 37 Base Services Group of the Nigerian Air Force, YOLA, Air Commodore Haruna Umar Mohammed, while handing over the suspects to the Department of State Security Service, YOLA said, the arrest followed a security surveillance by all the security agencies when the rifles of the command were stolen.
The Nigerian Air Force, as a professional fighting force and as part of the constitutional mandate, deemed it appropriate without prejudice that further investigation be carried out by the appropriate security agencies to make their preliminary findings on this sensitive issue known to the general public.
He reiterated the commitment of the Nigerian Air Force in complementing other security agents in providing security to the society. In Yola, Rayan Ubala, NTA News.
From Yola, we now go to Lagos, where the deplorable state of roads in some parts of the city poses a total hardship to residents. Abdullahi will tell us more on that report and many other reports coming from the zone. It is over to you.
Thanks for joining us in Lagos, Ronke. A federal high court sitting in Lagos has declined jurisdiction over a legal action instituted by a civil rights lawyer, Ebun Oluwadegboruwa, challenging President Muhammadu Buhari's appointment of Colonel Hamid Ali, retired, as the Comptroller General of the Nigeria Customs Service. Tunde Saiki has more.
The case instituted by Ebun Oluwadegboruwa in November 2015 following the appointment of Colonel Hamid Ali, retired, as the Comptroller General of the Nigeria Customs Service by President Muhammadu Buhari, on the ground that the appointment violated Section 2 of the Nigeria Customs Service Act 2002. This section provides for only persons occupying the office of a deputy controller to be considered for an appointment or elevation to the position of a Comptroller General, contrary to the appointment of Colonel Hamid Ali. Justice Suli Hassan said, the originator of the suit has no local standard since he is not a public officer, not a staff of the Nigeria Customs Service, and has not shown any proof that he had suffered from the appointment of Colonel Hamid Ali as the Customs Controller General. The court noted that Section 5 of the 1999 Constitution empowers the President to make appointments. He said even if there was a violation of any section of the Customs Act, the Constitution covers the President, who has executive powers to make such appointments. Justice Suli Hassan therefore struck out the case for lack of jurisdiction.
The court has given a judgment in his own wisdom. We as lawyers, I commended the judge, and the judge also commended us for keeping the government on its toes. Once there is a law in Nigeria by which specifications were made on who can be appointed as a customs controller general, I believe that law should be upheld. So the court has not address the substantive issue that I have raised, but on the issue of technicality as to whether I had local standard not being a member of the Nigerian Customs Service.
Barrister Adegboruwa also added that he may decide on an appeal after studying the full details of the judgment. In Lagos, Tunde Saiki, NTA News.
The Lagos State Police Command has paraded five suspects who were involved in the robbery of Wilson Onazi, the father of a Nigeria Super Eagles midfielder, Ogeni Onazi. The State Commissioner of Police, Fatayo Osheni, said the suspect will be handed over to the Plateau State Command for further investigation. Dr. Ogunyemi tells us more.
The State Commissioner of Police, Fatayo Osheni, said the suspect, a gang of five men led by Okuchukwu Ebuka, broke into the house of Pa Wilson Onazi, the father of a Nigerian Super Eagle midfielder, Ogeyi Onazi, in Jos, Plateau State, and carted away with valuables and a Highlander Jeep. He said his men intercepted the gang around Ajangbadi area of Lagos while making moves to sell the stolen vehicle.
The five suspects are with us. They will be paraded before you, including the car that was recovered.
The commissioner also said the command nabbed a gang who specializes in vandalizing telecommunications masts. He also paraded a woman who dumped her newborn baby inside a sack near a canal. Some of the suspects speak.
We took him to his bed, took him to his bedroom and asked him to go.
Mr. Owosheni advised citizens to be vigilant while carrying out ATM transactions and report suspicious moves around their neighborhood. In Lagos, Dotun Ogunyemi, NTA News.
Lagos boasts of hundreds of service roads and highways which allow for easier access to various parts of the metropolis. Most of these roads have not been adequately maintained over the years, so are in dilapidated states. NTA News examines the impact of the gridlock caused by bad roads and possible solutions.
The various towns and locations in Lagos are linked by about 9,000 roads and highways. It is also estimated that about 5 million vehicles ply these roads on a daily basis. In view of these statistics, it is pertinent for these roads to be constantly maintained to ensure free flow of traffic. This, however, is not the case, as persistent lack of maintenance on this road has left most of them in a deplorable state. The bad portion of the road by Bonny Camp on Ahmadu Bello Way, which has continuously defied all forms of rehabilitation, is one example. On a normal day, the heavy traffic as a result of the deplorable part of the road usually generates a gridlock that spans at least 5 to 6 miles.
If you buy a brand new vehicle under 3-6 months, we are not doing fourth hand and sixth hand. I mean, you can guess what we are going through.
They should employ or go back to former public works department, those days, PWD. When jobs, when something, when road spoils, they repair it immediately. But this time around, nobody cares.
Apart from lack of constant maintenance of the roads, experts say they are exposed to the effect of water stagnation, which arises from lack of drainage systems. The consensus among various observers is that relevant authorities must ensure regular monitoring and maintenance of the roads by providing adequate fund and supervision.
And those are top stories from Lagos at this time. It's back to Ronke, who has more stories in Abuja. Ronke, over to you.
Thank you, Abdullahi. And now to politics. The All Progressives Congress, APC, has described the People's Democratic Party's criticism of the administration of President Muhammadu Buhari as a move to return the country to voodoo economics and reckless fiscal policies experienced during the immediate post-PDP administration. The APC says the PDP wants to return the country to the years where it said looting of the country was the order of the day and an orchestrated plot to deflect attention from the economic mess it left behind. According to a statement by the National Secretary of the APC, Malabuni, the administration of President Muhammadu Buhari is open to and welcomes positive and constructive contributions on resolving the country's economic challenges and assures Nigerians that legitimate and innovative means are already in place to restore the country's battered economy back to health in the quickest possible time. The APC appeals for patience and cooperation from Nigerians as the Buhari administration works assiduously to pull the country out of the present hardship and restore the country on the path of growth in all facets. The preservation of the ozone layer has been a global issue due to its depletion by man-made activities. As Nigeria joins the rest of the world to observe International Day for the Preservation of the Ozone Layer, Chimdima Anson Agomo extols the factors responsible and the way forward.
The ozone layer is simply a fragile shield of gas that protects the Earth from the harmful portion of sun rays, thus helping to preserve life on the planet. In 1994, the UN General Assembly proclaimed 16 September as the International Day for the Preservation of Ozone Layer, while commemorating the date of the signing in 1987 of the Montreal Protocol on substances that depletes the ozone layer. The day is devoted to promote activities and global efforts in addressing climate change. But how can ozone layer be preserved?
You know, certain chemical substances that have been manufactured to provide comfort, you know, to human beings are now known to destroy the ozone layer. These substances are substances that are used as refrigerants in refrigeration and air conditioning. They are substances that are used to manufacture foam.
The theme for this year is climate and ozone restored by a world united. And yes, the essence for choosing the team is basically to phase in ozone friendly and climate friendly alternatives in the refrigeration and air condition sector, and also in the foam sector.
Some Nigerians spoke on what they know about preservation of ozone layer.
If not for ozone layer, the heat that would have been coming to rot that we have been receiving would have been too much for us to bear.
The inflation of gas affects the ozone layers, and that's what makes the sun to more heavier on us.
It helps because they release oxygen to decongest the carbon dioxide we have there and the heat.
It may interest you to know that quite a number of people do not know what preservation of ozone layer is all about.
Actually, I don't have idea.
No, I don't know.
In Abuja, Chidima Anson Agomo, NTN News.
Leading policymakers, practitioners and investors on the African continent have emphasized on the need for housing infrastructure to keep pace with growing urbanization in Africa and Nigeria in particular. This was during the 2016 annual conference of the African Union for Housing Finance held in Abuja. Tennis Adedmiloye reports.
The conference is designed to reflect a balance between the need to craft policies that will drive sustainable housing finance on the African continent and offer practical solutions to providing access to affordable housing finance to the growing ranks of people in Africa.
We need an enabled environment to do this. It's a combination of investment and advisory that would make us be successful in this market.
We must also create, as I described it, an escalator that allows people to be able to step on, be able to access and own their own homes.
Former Governor Fashola for the Lagos state did all sorts of reforms in that state. Some of the other 35 states need to follow suit and look at how they can make land more available, cut the costs of transferring property.
It's important that on the financing side, that the financial products that are developed and that are offered match the affordability of the consumer.
The contribution of the housing market to the GDP in Nigeria is less than 1%. But compare that with the United States economy, for instance. The housing market in the United States represents nearly 80% of the GDP.
The African Union for Housing Finance 2016 conference will draw out solutions to affordable housing finance set in the context of the theme, Housing and Africa's Growth Agenda. In Abuja, Dennis Adigunloye, NTA News.
Now to election issues. The Election Petition Tribunal sitting in Umuahia has upheld the election of Senator Mao Ohuabomwa, representing Abia North Senatorial District at the National Assembly. The Tribunal Chairman, Justice James Abundaga, dismissed the petition of the former governor of Abia State, Uzokalu, for failing to prove his allegations. Dennis Temple tells us more.
Issues formulated for consideration by the tribunal are whether the petitioner has satisfactorily proved his allegation, whether the elections declared in some polling units were inconclusive, and whether the subsequent declaration was proper.
The tribunal chairman resolved in his ruling that the petitioner failed to prove his allegations that elections were marred by incidences of electoral violence and thuggery. On allegation of overvoting, the learned justice said over 4,200 votes, which were initially credited to Chief Ojudokalo, were wrongly calculated. One of the counsels to the respondent explained, even as the counsel to the petitioner declined comment.
When the results of the election from the polling units are balanced against what they finally entered into the ward results, that the votes for PPA were inflated by over 4,000 votes, and the tribunal agreed with us. So apart from dismissing the petition, the tribunal found that Mao scored more votes than the candidate of the PPA by over 4,000 votes.
Senator Mao Ohuabomwa was elected under the platform of the People's Democratic Party to represent the Abia North Senatorial District at the National Assembly. The election, which was upturned at the appeal court, who ordered a rerun election, which Chief Uzokalo said were marred by electoral malfeasance. In Umuahia, Dennis Temple, NTN News.
Thank you, Dennis. Efforts are on to ensure safety on Nigerian roads. We now join Daoju in Ibadan Network Center for this and other stories.
Hello, Ronke. Good to see you. Good evening and welcome to Ibadan. Agencies in Oyo State have advocated for consciousness of the people on their safety and peace in the state in the last 4 months of the year. In this report, correspondent Oyeyika Folaromi examines the preparation of the security agencies for the Ember months.
It is the general belief that road traffic crashes and insecurity are associated with the last 4 months of the year, popularly called Ember Month. Experts blame the trend on poor state of some major roads, excessive speed, lack of planning, and inability of some members of public to supply useful information to security agencies. The Federal Road Safety Commission, FRSC, in Oyo State said it has intensified enlightenment on safety tips for motorists and other road users.
We get involved with our stakeholders and the general public to create more and more awareness on the usage of the road.
Also of importance during the Ember Month is the issue of security of lives and property.
The operation order have been prepared, and we have started the execution.
But we are not magicians. We cannot be everywhere at all time. So where you are, what is happening around you, get us informed in good time, and we'll be there.
They therefore assure the people of the state of maximum execution of security and safety plans during these last 4 months of the year in Ibadan. Oyeyinka Folaromi, NTA News.
Meanwhile, the Federal Road Safety Corps says it will be strict in the enforcement of use of speed-limiting device from October 1st this year. The Ogbomosho unit of the agency said this during the awareness campaign among motorists in the town. Correspondent Dayo Ogunshola reports.
The men and officers of the Federal Road Safety Corps Ogbomosho Unit Command took time to engage motorists that Taki, the art of the ancient town of Ogbomosho, about the importance of the device and why they should be embraced for the good of all road users.
The
The unit commandant observed that since overspeeding has been identified as one of the major causes of death and casualties on the Nigerian road, the use of speed-limiting device will make good impact on a critical corridor like Oyo Ogbomoso axis.
If people can reduce their speed, especially Ogbomoso Oyo road, where we have seen that it's a very critical area concerning road safety crashes, if the speed can be reduced, definitely crashes will be reduced too.
The sensitization campaign was part of advocacy engagement organized for stakeholders in Ogbomoso by the unit command to reduce carnages on the road. In Ogbomoso, Dayo Ogbomosola, NTA News.
Nigerians and citizens of other countries resident in Nigeria have been told to respect the national symbols in the interest of the integrity of the country. The National Orientation Agency, NOA, in Oyo State made this remark at a sensitization walk on National Ordnance Day held in Ibadan. Yemisi Ajagun reports.
The 16th of September every year is set aside by the federal government of Nigeria to create awareness and enlightenment for citizens and residents to respect the national symbols. This is the work of the National Orientation Agency in Oyo State to sensitize residents of Ibadan on the importance of these symbols, which include national flag, coat of arms, national anthem, and the Nigerian currency, among others. This sensitization work was led by NOA coordinator in Oyo State, Dolapo Dosumu.
The Nigerian flag is not supposed to be perfect. It's not supposed to be sewn together. It's seamless. So we're employing public and private institutions to enable hoist national flag in their premises.
The Oyo Commissioner of Information, Toye Arulogu, and other Nigerians also comment.
Locally here, since it's a national event, locally here, for example, we also go out to see that pictures of the governor that we have the announcements of 2009. So those are the kind of things that we do.
We already tell our people in market that we are not scrutinizing their money, either to take it into their dress and then put it into their bag and fold it. We don't want it.
Nigerians, we should be proud of our colors. Wherever we are, our money should be handled in decent ways.
They commended the present administration for championing the reorientation of the people into good virtues. From Ibadan, Yemisi Ajagun, NTA News.
And that's our contribution from Ibadan. Ronke is back to you in Abuja for continuation of Nationwide. Good afternoon.
Afternoon to you too, Dawju. Thanks for coming on board today. All major streets leading to the Bauchi State capital will soon be dualized. Governor Muhammad Abdullahi Abubakar stated this while receiving the Emir of Bauchi, Alhaji Rilwanu Suleiman Adamu, on Salah homage. Abbas Meikano reports.
The weather in Bauchi and Emoros on Salah Day was rainy, which started the previous night and necessitated the observance of Eid prayer at the central mosque in place of the usual Eid crown. The Bauchi State Governor Muhammad Abdullahi Abubakar and the Emir of Bauchi Alhaji Rilwanu Suleiman Adamu arrived at the mosque around 8:30 while the prayer commenced at exactly 9 a.m. led by the Chief Imam of Bauchi, Imam Bala Ahmed Baban Inna. As usual, Imam delivered his sermon shortly after the prayer. Important messages in the sermon include the significance of sacrifice, the categories of animals required for the sacrifice, and the recommended way of sharing the meat. He explained that the sacrifice, which is in accordance with the divine command to Prophet Ibrahim to sacrifice his son Ismail, but later replaced with a ram, is only for those that can afford the means. The Emir of Bauchi later slaughtered his ram, symbolizing the commencement of the occasion. In his Salah message, the Emir of Bauchi, Alhaji Rilwanu Suleiman Adamu, expressed the importance of peace and harmonious coexistence among different backgrounds, as well as special prayers for the state, the country, and Nigerians performing this year's Hajj exercise in Saudi Arabia. Later in his residence, the state governor, Muhammad Abdullahi, joined thousands of Muslims in offering his sacrifice. However, the celebration this year was without usual Salah horse riding and procession following the rainy weather condition. Bauchi, Abbas Mekano, NTA News.
The Chief Judge of the Federal High Court, Justice Ibrahim Auta, says poor funding of the nation's court, lack of cooperation by lawyers and desperation of litigants are the major causes of conflicting judgments from the courts. He stated this in an exclusive interview with NTA's judiciary correspondent Fabio Kowo as part of preparation for the commencement of the new legal year.
Though it has been recorded at various times in the past, 2016 seems to have seen more notable cases of conflicting judgments from courts, with major examples in the PDP leadership cases and the Abia governorship tussle. The common questions people have asked is how come judges do not know if cases before them are also replicated in another court. But the Chief Judge of the Federal High Court, who should normally assign these cases in federal high courts, says except such matters pass through him, there is no way judges in other jurisdictions can know of the existence of similar matters. The saving grace for the nation's justice system, Justice Ibrahim Auta says, would have been the existence of an internet clearinghouse, which would immediately alert a judge of the existence of a similar matter before a brother judge. But poor funding of the judiciary has stalled such projects.
There's no way humanly possible the chief judge will know what is happening all around. We are planning to have a central system here in Abuja. Even if the case is filed in Port Harcourt, the chief judge should be able to see the case in front of him in a monitor. So all this goes to funding.
Chief Judge of the Federal High Court says another solution is for lawyers and litigants to desist from forum shopping.
Unfortunately, the bar are not helping the issue. They are not helping the court. The one filed in Lagos, why was he filed in Lagos? The headquarters of those parties are here in Abuja.
Details of the exclusive interview will come up on NTA's legal program, The Scale, which begins to run on Monday. In Abuja, Femi Okewu, NTA News.
In other news, work for the reconstruction of mini bridge on Bauchi Kano Federal Highway has reached advanced level of completion. Abbas Mekano reports that this followed a prompt intervention by the Bauchi state government as the road has cut off around Ningi local government area of the state.
The road, which is one of the major federal highways in the state, has been playing a vital role in the socio-economic development of the state over the years. Following a heavy downpour recently, the road was cut up near Sangaya village, Ningi local government, which prompted the swift action of the state government and awarded the reconstruction of a mini bridge to accommodate the volume of water passing underneath. Governor Mohamed Abubakar, during inspection visit to the site, expressed delight with the quality and speed of the work.
Even though this is a federal road, so we'll do this and then hopefully when the federal government now realizes and appreciates what we have done, they may or may not refund us our money. But it's not going to be money down the drain because the good people of Bauchi State are using this bridge.
Work which engulfed about 84 million naira is being carried out by Trihepta Construction Company and has reached appreciable level of completion. Members of the community commended the governor for the swift intervention towards reconstruction of the mini bridge. Abbas Mekano, NTA News.
This is news nationwide on NTA Network Service. We now take some messages. The news returns shortly.
When has it reached this? Much less this. And this. And this. And this. Help reclaim our commonwealth. Lend your support to the fight against corruption for a better Nigeria.
The NSCDC Public Enlightenment Program, The Defender, is back on NTA Network every Monday, 6:30 to 7 p.m. Stay tuned.
We intend to radically change Newman Street. My company has a track record of converting slums into new cities. Many years of experience has taught us to fish out allies within the communities we want to transform.
Don't listen to your husband. Listen to me. Give me a boy, and the two of you may never even have to work again.
How are you?
Hey, what's your name?
Akpos.
America.
Oh, Akpos, America.
Love you, yeah.
Wow. Love you too.
Wonderful, wonder. Wonderful, wonder. Wonderful, wonder. 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 Wonder.
Do you know who I am?
You're a sad commentary.
What is the name, Miji? Now they're calling me for my place. If I catch you, you're born like this, I go break up.
When I told him I was getting belly for another person.
This week on your award-winning comedy series, Professor John Bull, starring Kanayo Okanayo, Mercy Johnson, Queen Wokoye, Funky Malam, Bimbo Akintola, Oguz Baba, Yomi Fash Lanso, MC for God, Junior Pope.
My name is Fusan, Samson's friend.
No wonder you behave like him.
Bad Nego.
That's not my name. Stop him.
Don't know what him be a name.
My name is Abad Nego.
Don't know what him attack. Bad day.
Professor John Bull, fasten your seatbelts this Tuesday and Friday, 8:30 to 9 p.m. on NTA Network International and Star Times. It's absolutely bombastic.
Over and out. The largest data network, Glow, grandmasters of data.
Sharon Ultimate Hotels, Abuja. The ultimate place to be.
If we have lost the opportunity of 15 years, let us no longer lose any opportunity for the future. Our alternative is agriculture, immediately, and solid minerals.
We should be appreciative of the president who has again diverted attention to this issue of agriculture.
The present administration is determined to go back to planning, identify priorities beforehand. When money comes, it is applied to that purpose. And you can see the results.
We are determined to rehabilitate our country, especially for our children and our grandchildren.
For over 25 years, I have been privileged to anchor various programs on television. But the news program that I find most exciting and challenging is The Weekend File. This is largely because of its philosophy of engaging all classes of people, the artisans, politicians, technocrats, captains of industry, and professional analysts on issues that touch all aspects of life and living. In the conversations that follow, you find complexities, different views, ideologies, thought patterns, and individual beliefs. It's quite engaging. We do this Saturdays on NTA Network Service at 9 p.m. It's Weekend File, but you call it Weekend Companion, and it's all about nation building. Join me, Kirin Umayo, and production crew every Saturday for this weekend tweet, and I can tell you that it is unmissable. Make it a day.
Glad you're still watching. Federal government commences reconstruction of collapsed bridge on Kaduna Kano Road. This and other stories as we join Abdullahi in our Kaduna studios. It is over to you.
Thank you very much, Ronke, and welcome. The Federal Ministry of Works has moved to reconstruct the collapsed bridge on the Kaduna Zaria Highway, which has posed a great challenge to motorists plying the road. Austin Anyebe, who visited the project site, reports.
For some months now, plying Kano Kaduna Road has been a nightmare to so many motorists. This is because of a near collapse of bridge in Jaji.
Following the untold hardship brought to road users, the Federal Ministry of Works has mobilized a consortium firm to site to reconstruct the bridge in order to ease traffic.
We realized sometime in February, one of the cross beam, it's a steel beam, had broken down, and the bridge started leaning towards that. After the accident, the reinforcement in the concrete started coming out. So then we knew the bridge has already collapsed.
Explaining to NTA News, the contractor says the bridge constructed in the 60s can no longer cope with the current volume of traffic on the highway, therefore necessitating new design.
We are rebuilding the bridge to the new current standard of 2016.
Motorists who have resorted to several diversions and maneuvering appealed for speedy work.
I imagine the federal government to consider it important in finishing this road, this bridge, which will allow the passengers to be moving without any hitch.
People are suffering too much on the road. Because if you look at the road has already gone out of control.
They said several accidents have been recorded in the area since the portion of road was blocked. The contractor handling the work has 90 days to complete the work, which he started in August. In Kaduna, Austin Anyebe, NTA News.
Speakers at a seminar organized by Center for Democratic Development and Training in Kaduna have attributed the continued conflict between farmers and herders in the country to encroachment on grazing reserves. Muhammad Umar Ajingi has the details of the meeting.
For years now, some northern states have been experiencing clashes between farmers and pastoralists, resulting to loss of lives and property. The need to provide a solution to some of these problems gave birth to the seminar by Center for Democratic Development and Training, whose findings reveal that incursions into each other's territories by both farmers and herdsmen is a major cause of the conflicts. Director of the center, Dr. Abubakar Sadiq, noted that clashes between Fulani herdsmen and farmers has displaced hundreds of farmers.
I think various governments, especially in Kaduna State, they have started addressing some of these issues.
The representative of Kaduna State Governor, Permanent Secretary, Ministry of Agriculture and Forestry, Dr. Abdulkadir Qasim, alongside representative of Minister of Defense, Dr. Hassan Abdullahi, said government is committed to ameliorating the challenges.
Government is not resting on its own. The minister has assiduously discussed with the militaries, and we are working towards maintaining peace.
Speakers at the event were unanimous in their submission that the marketing grazing reserves, sensitization as well as enforcement of relevant laws to punish offenders will bring an end to the conflict between farmers and herdsmen in Nigeria. In Kaduna, I am Muhammad Umar Ajingi, NTA News.
Senator representing Southern Kaduna Senatorial District, Danjumala, has urged people of Jaba Local Government Area and Gadabu Village in Godogodo Chiefdom of Jama'a Local Government Area to remain calm and vigilant. He stated this when he visited the areas to have information on the earth tremor occurrence in Jaba and gunmen attack on residents of Gadabu Village. Correspondent Tina Toro has the details.
In Poi, Jaba Local Government Area, Senator Danjumala was briefed on the earth tremor, an incident which occurred more than 10 times in 2 days, affecting over 200 houses. Senator La also visited the Pope camp, then Ladi Get Modi, where he advised the people to remain calm. At Gadabu Village in Godogodo Chiefdom of Jama Local Government Area, the village was almost deserted, except for security operatives and few villagers who informed the senator that the attacks are still ongoing in form of ambush, especially when they are on their farms. The villagers noted that the security operatives lack enough manpower to protect the area. Senator La promised to look into the situation and urged the people to be vigilant and help the security operatives with useful information and not to take laws into their hands, as government is doing everything possible to bring an end to the attacks. In Kaduna, Tina Tumi, NTA News.
And with that report, it's back to you, Runke, for more on the Nationwide. Good afternoon.
Thank you. And moving on now, the Joint Admission and Matriculation Board, JAMB, has affirmed that the Senate and academic boards of institutions are solely responsible for admissions without interference from the board. The event was the Extraordinary Technical Committee meeting on admissions into first choice institutions. Franca Uzoma Oloa reports.
These are admission officers from various institutions of higher learning. They are here to select suitably qualified candidates into various tertiary institutions. The placement exercise is also in line with the guidelines of the 60-40 science-earth ratio for conventional universities, 80-20 science-earth ratio for non-conventional universities, and 70-30 technology-non-technology ratio for national diploma awarding institutions.
What we are saying is that people should follow the due process. Universities have the right to determine the criteria for admission, but the criteria must be reasonable. The criteria must be explicit.
With an approved admissions deadline of 30th November 2016, federal universities are also expected to comply with the quota stipulated by the Federal Executive Council in the area of merit, catchment, and educationally less developed states.
We are going to go by merit first and foremost, because we will not leave somebody that scored highly and take people that didn't score highly. Since we don't have enough capacity, to take all of them, we just have to filter the best out of them and admit.
The difference between this year's admissions process and that of the previous years is the no written post-UTME test policy by the federal government. Franca Uzoma Olua, NTA News.
Next is Global Tidbits with Chimdima Udubisi.
Kenya's young entrepreneurs have come up with high-tech solutions for agriculture on mobile phones. They are now mentoring other younger ones on the benefits of staying in the rural areas to farm than migrating to the cities. And the United Nations report on South Sudan's crisis shows that people fleeing the country since the violence began in December 2013 till date have passed the 1 million mark. Also, over 1.6 million people are internally displaced despite last year's signed peace deal. In another development, European Union leaders are meeting in Slovakia with a view to forming a common ground in the face of Britain's exit from the bloc. German Chancellor Angela Merkel, terming EU's situation as critical, is optimistic that the summit will come up with resolutions on improved security, cooperation, and the economy. Elsewhere in the United States, the government has accepted to pay $1.2 million to the family of an Italian aid worker killed by its drone operations in Pakistan last year. That's Global Tidbits. Chimdima Ndibisi, NTN News.
And Ayodeji Makinde is ready with sports update.
Nigeria's under-19 cricket team are confident of bouncing back against Ghana on Saturday in their fifth match of the 2018 Cricket World Cup qualifiers ongoing in Benoni, Johannesburg. The junior Yellow Greens, who had won three straight matches against Zambia, Rwanda and Sierra Leone, lost by a wicket in the second innings to Botswana, who raced to 103 for the loss of 9 wickets in 31.5 overs Thursday. 88 lady golfers from different clubs in the northern zone of the country are participating in a two-day Ladies Golf Association of Nigeria Championship at the GEJ Golf Club, Nigeria Air Force Base, Abuja. The 36-hole event, which was teed off by General Ibrahim Haruna Friday, also attracted 7 guest players from the eastern zone as part of efforts to further improve friendly relationship among lady golfers in Nigeria.
We have a lot of young lady golfers who we can groom, encourage, and maybe in the near future we have representatives in the Olympics.
It's a good competition for the development of ladies golf, and it's a good avenue also to showcase the GEJ Golf Club.
Jude Nwigwe said that though death surely comes, it is a gateway that every program passes to eternal life. It was at a service in his honor at Our Lady Queen of Nigeria Pro Cathedral, Abuja. Ifeanyi Izumba reports.
Reverend Father Nwigwe, taking his text from the Book of St. John, told the congregation that there is always an hour to ask for God's glory in the life of a Christian. The day is a significant moment for late Justin Abua, who has left the world, and to pray for him to say goodbye.
Standing in the house of God here to say goodbye to him, it reminds us too of our own time, when the Lord himself will be calling on every one of us to come back to him, to the eternal home.
At the graveside, Reverend Father Nwigwe prayed the late Abua may find joy in the company of the Lord and the saints forever.
We commit his body to the earth from which it was made.
An absolute ally.
He was always ready with a laugh, a funny story. He was very easy to talk to.
At a night of tributes, family, friends and colleagues, saying his death came as a shock, described him as a presidential historian who draws a line between what you need to know and what he considers a state secret. The permanent secretary in the State House was represented by Mr. Gabriel Afu.
We in State House were still in shock, considering the experience he has gathered there in State House after serving over 8 presidents.
He is a man whose life will continue to remain an example for all the junior ones who worked under him.
Those left behind should not forget the way OJ performed creditably.
Most extraordinarily a humorous man.
The late Justin Onwara Abua died at the age of 57 in Abuja. Ifeanyi Izumba, NTN News.
We wish him an eternal rest. It's on that note, we thank you for watching Nationwide. I am Runke Kolawole. Do have the best of the weekend.